Hi, I'm Tim Berglund with StarTree. To understand what Apache Pinot is and what it does, it helps to start with some historical perspective. Let's start maybe 30 years before this recording in the early 90s with some person who is dressed in a suit and sitting in a corner office. This person makes important decisions about money and things in the business, right? They're an executive in the business. And what they want and what the technology was able to deliver to them at the time was in the morning a report. Let's imagine it's printed and in a binder and there's some kind of pie chart, some other stuff on there. And so this report was based on the activity of the business from the previous day. This is where modern analytics was born. This is where the whole practice of ETL came from. And this was a game changer. The ability to have insight into what happened just a day ago for that important decision maker was huge. Now, in the ensuing decades, a few things have happened. One is the role of analytics in the org chart has changed, right? Instead of just that important decision maker, there's been this migration downward where more and more people need access to analytics products. There's also been pressure on cycle time. Yesterday is a long time ago, and increasingly we'd like that to be hours or maybe even minutes, and the tool sets built back then have been a little stressed by particularly that time crunch. And increasingly, there's a broader definition of decision maker that pushes that outside the business to users of the application. As business becomes an increasingly digital thing, we're interacting through apps, websites, more of the transactions that govern our lives are digital. Those users are more and more needing to see what the state of the system is. So we're not just pushing down the org chart, but outside the organization. Let me give you an example. Let's say Uber Eats. Now, here, I'll make a burger here, some sesame seeds, some lettuce. Well, trust me, that's a burger. And so if I want to order one of those, I'll open up Uber Eats and say, okay, what are the 5 burger joints near me? There's probably 5 of them, right? I'm really hungry, so I want that burger right now. So I need to know what the average delivery time is for those 5 burger joints. Now that's an analytics query and I'm a user. So that very much right there is user-facing analytics. Now there are a few things that are different about this game, this user-facing analytics game, than about the internal analytics that we started with. Let me just draw those out here. First, we're gonna have latency. This is what occurs to me first. Now I'm looking at this mobile app. I need things to feel live. It can't take 15 seconds, it can't take a minute for one of these queries to execute. It's probably going to need to take on the order of the tens of milliseconds, right? I'd like there. Now, over here in this world, well, that could take really minutes. Hundreds of seconds would be okay for certain queries in the old world. I'm just building a report. You know, that's not such a big deal. That can take a while. So what's next? We've got freshness. Now, as I am looking at this, the restaurant's near me, it's say 5:45, it's kind of rush time, it's dinner. This has to be very new data, right? This can't be data that's been hanging around. Maybe in the old world, we could have freshness on the order of, easily minutes worth of freshness here. And I'm gonna say freshness on the order of a second would be important, because that delivery time could be changing a lot during a rush. If I'm getting an answer from 5 minutes ago, that could be a very inaccurate answer if a rush has just happened. So I need kind of freshness on the order of seconds. And we're also going to have a new thing that's a little bit different, and that's going to be concurrency, right? So now in a very successful app, I could have 1 million users all at once. Over here, what am I going to have, 100 people using the application at once? That would seem to be a lot of concurrent queries, but big differences here in concurrency. So latency, freshness, concurrency, you can see literally orders of magnitude of difference between the requirements for internal analytics and user-facing analytics. And let's just be explicit about that. Here, over on this end of the spectrum, is this internal world. This is not a bad thing. Again, it's a game-changing thing, and it's a world that has continued to evolve into tools like, say, BigQuery, Snowflake, Presto. It's well served by a variety of different, all three of those are categorically different tools, but all serving this sort of dashboarding, internal-facing analytics world. Over here, this is what I'm going to call user-facing. If you try to be a user-facing analytics database with it, again, you are taking on a lot of responsibility yourself for computing aggregates and doing other things that should be in the data infrastructure. So it can be done with existing tools, but there are definite downsides in terms of operational cost and application development cost, which sometimes can be even more daunting. Apache Pinot is a database purpose-built for user-facing real-time analytics. It was built by a team at LinkedIn to power some user-facing analytics requirements that had been really conceived of, ideas that people had for changes they wanted to make in how LinkedIn worked. They didn't really have good ways of doing it. When we look at Pinot architecturally, how it fits into a system, there are kind of three things to think about. Ingest, it's an analytics database, so it's going to ingest from operational sources, the database itself, and the application interface. Let's look at all of those. Now, when it comes to ingest, what are we going to have? We're going to have, you know, relational databases out in the world, of course, likely some some Kafka topics. It's ingest from Kafka is a super slick thing. And probably, you know, imagine you could even have like a data lake. Let's just draw kind of some reeds growing here in the lake. That is typically not an operational data source, but it's not uncommon to ingest from a data lake and just have lower latency, fresher, and more concurrent analytics happening there. So these three things, let's take these down into Pinot, which is, it's a database. That's all it is. Now, what's going on in here? There's all kinds of internals to explore, but what you need to know at this point is the data model, and friends, that is tabular. It's you see tables, and they're exactly like the tables you've come to know and love. The columns have data types. The data types are all the usual suspects. The whole gang is there. And there's a bunch of possibilities for indexing of these columns in unique ways. When you get down to it, the value of a database has to do with, you know, how are you retrieving things? Now, different databases are optimized in different ways, but how can I read from it and how does that work? And that really comes down to indexes. There are lots of cool index types. There's a text index that's based on Lucene, Apache Lucene. There's a geospatial index, which of course would be important over here for these burgers, right? If I'm gonna know where the burger joints are near me, I'd need that. There's nested JSON indexing. You have arbitrarily nested JSON and build indexes on that. And of course there's the famous StarTree index. That's kind of like taking a pivot table and saving it to disk. So you can get this highly dimensional data with pre-computed aggregations and pull those out in what seems like supernaturally fast time. You get weird benchmarking results that just seem like something must be wrong, but it's not. It's just a super cool index. So lots of great stuff going on in there worth exploring. But really, you got tables, you got indexes, you have this high-speed ingest. There are 1 million events per second indexing happening in the real world in some of the biggest Pinot clusters. That's a thing that's doable. So what's looking at this? How do you see this data? Is it a dashboard? I mean, it could be, right? But the whole thing we're saying here is that dashboarding world is really for analytics inside the company. Pinot can absolutely deliver on those requirements, but Pinot is uniquely qualified to deliver analytics to applications. And these are things that your users are using. Let's just draw some of these little users down here to interact with the business, to do business with you. They're looking at these applications. You are pushing analytics products to them. You're exposing the state of the business to those users. How do they talk to Pinot? Well, the great news is these are all SQL queries. So it's really pretty easy to understand. It's a tabular data model. It's SQL. What it does that's different is these deliver on these requirements, latency, freshness, concurrency, in a way that is orders of magnitude different from the received tradition and the tool sets that have grown up around the requirements for internal facing reporting and dashboarding. So a number of things are happening here as you make this transition. Number one, you, assuming it's you who are building these applications, there's a bunch of database responsibility you're not taking on. You've got an infrastructure layer on here now that makes, say, Kafka queryable, or that prevents you from having to build this system, this key value store system that requires 10x higher operational costs and a lot more application development responsibility. You're pushing that into an infrastructure layer, which is always the right thing to do, right? You always want that undifferentiated stuff to be in the infrastructure, and the differentiated code about, you know, getting me a hamburger or showing me who viewed my profile and what sorts of titles do people have who have seen my profile in the last week and whatever these kind of initial Pinot use cases are, things like this, that's what you want to be delivering, not building infrastructure. Also, this data up here, we figured out how to extract the value of that data to deliver internally in reporting and dashboarding, but there's all this value locked up there that we're not pushing to users. And so it's a game changer. And the folks who are doing this already are finding that it can be a game changer for the services they build. And I don't want to lose that point. This is a new category. It's a category you are helping build. The question isn't, are you a meal delivery service or a social media site? I mean, almost none of us are, right? The question is, what is there in the state of the system, in the information that's locked up in the business here? Information that we've gotten very good at extracting value from for use internally, but what value is there that we can push down to users, including them in the community of decision makers, giving them what they need to make better decisions about how to interact with the service, with the business that you're exposing to them. That impulse right there, that is what user-facing analytics are all about. That is what Apache Pinot is here to help you build.